Alright. Now, last time, I covered Canelo strengths and weaknesses based on what we've seen from him in the ring and my ideas on what he should do to be able to stand a chance against Mayweather, which would be aiming punches towards Mayweather's chest and using the right hand to sweep around Floyd's low left arm that he keeps tucked against his body, you know, kind of hit him on the backside a little bit, because in boxing, you know, you're not supposed to hit on the back, but, you know, every now and again, you know, y'all see some punches that, you know, land a little bit farther back on the side. The refs don't really do nothing about them, but just something flagrant. So, that's one thing Canelo needs to do, use the right hand around the side, and also try to, you know, throw it over the hand, over Floyd's shoulder, and aim for the chest. But, this video we're going to be focusing on Mayweather, and, it's not going to be as long as the video for Canelo, because we already know what to expect from Mayweather. Now, I'm not saying we don't know what to expect from Canelo, because, you know, he's had 43 fights, and in 43 fights, there's not really a high chance of you seeing anything different from a fighter than what you've already seen. I mean, you've already seen Canelo's head movement. If you go back and watch, I think it was this fight with Alfonso Gomez or Kermit Central. I'm pretty sure it was Gomez. Whatever fight was on the undercard of the Mayweather-Ortiz fight card, which I'm pretty sure was Gomez and Canelo. Go back and watch that, and you'll see that Canelo did display head movement in that fight. Now, the only reason people took more notice to it than the Trout fight is because Trout was missing so much. And the reason Trout misses so much is because, one, he's not accurate. Two, he doesn't throw his jab with any meaningful purpose. He just throws it out there, throws it out there, throws it out there. And, you know, I don't know what his deal with that is, whether he does it to, you know, constantly keep his opponent off balance, out of rhythm, or if that's just the type of fighter he is, where he just likes to jab when he can't figure out what his next step is or whatever, and he's trying to set up his tank. And the problem with that is, he never put an attack behind that jab. So you're looking at the punch stats for that Trout threw 416 jabs. It's rare that you see a person throw almost 100 more jabs than power punches. And the reason I'm bringing this up is because, you know, Mayweather, on average, lands double in percentage of what Trout lands in that fight. And Canelo, Trout threw almost as much jabs as Canelo had total punches. Canelo had 431 punches. Trout threw 416 jabs, which is just kind of crazy. He did outland Canelo in that fight, but obviously, you know, it was Canelo who was landing the better shots, and, you know, fights aren't won based on who lands the most punches. And the thing with Mayweather is, he is no doubt going to be the highest competition Canelo has faced so far, and, you know, it's obvious that he is, because, you know, look at how many world title holders that he's defeated. You know, he's beaten so many of them.
And Canelo's biggest challenge so far has been Austin Trout. And, you know, Trout, he is a good fighter. But, you know, he isn't on Mayweather's class. He's not on Mayweather's level. And they had something they showed. If you're not familiar with the plus minus ratings, just put a CompuBox online and they'll have it up there. You can look up, it's only active fighters, but they don't show all fighters. They only show fighters who have had, meaningful fights. That's basically it. Fighters who, stand out because of the opposition they would face. You know, so if he hasn't faced good enough opposition, well then, you know, you're not going to be on that list. So, you're looking at it. Austin Trout lands 30% of his punches on average in his last 5 fights. And what I was saying was, I consider a person to have good accuracy when they land 35% or better. Or anywhere between 35 to 38. At the lowest, should say 36, 37, but also depends on their opponents. So like you see the top of this, Alvarez, on his last 5 fights, that's the minimum that you lose. He's in at 42% overall. And who was it? Mayweather is at 41. Under them is Santa Cruz, who's at 37. It was Ronnie Lara at 36. Andre Ward's at 38. They have Julio Cesar Chavez, you know, Jr. He surprisingly lands, you know, higher than I thought he did. He lands at 40. And, you know, below that, below 35, you can't really say the person's that accurate of a puncher, because they miss too much. They miss too much. So, you look at that, and then you look at the fact that normally people land 24% against Canelo. What I was saying about defense is, I consider a person to have good defense if people's connect percentage is 20 or below. So you have Arizlandi Lara, you have Mayweather, you have Guillermo Rigondeaux on there as the top 3 defensive fighters whenever you're looking at what people land against them. And I'm not talking about top 3 in terms of plus minus ratio overall. I'm talking about in terms of their opponent's connect percentage. And the reason I bring this up is because before fighting Austin Trout, Canelo has been fighting people who are overmatched. Don't worry, I'll get to Mayweather here in a second. Canelo has been fighting people who basically were calf drivers, if you want to look at it like that. They're people who don't really have, you know, a whole lot of credibility. And then leading up to his fight with Trout, his 2 fights before that were against old man Mosley and Jose Cito Lopez. Now, when you look at the fights leading up to that, the fights with Gomez, Cintron, Mosley, and Lopez, like I said in the other video, look at those 4 fights, and Canelo averaged 45.8 overall connect percentage in those 4 fights leading up to Trout. Against Trout, he only landed 29% mother sponges. And trout, on average, you know, people land 23% against him. On average, people land 24% against Canelo. So you look at that, and you see that their defense is about the same. But then, you know, you look at Trout's punch output, it hadn't changed compared to, you know, his recent fights. It didn't change at all. Well, I won't say it didn't change at all. Trout did land about 9% less than what he normally does. And he threw an average of 64 punches around in his four fights leading up to Canelo. He was throwing 72 punches around. And Alvarez in this fight, but before, it was saying he threw about 52 punches around. And against Trout, he threw about 36 around. And it's interesting that, you know, for the type of fighter that Canelo is, you see the way you see him fight, that you wouldn't think that, you know, he would throw that much less coming up into this fight with Trout. And it's kind of crazy, because normally you hear how against Mayweather people throw less than they normally do and land less than they normally do, and that happened to Canelo. So what I can say is, going into this fight, Mayweather still has, you know, the high edge. I don't see him getting knocked out. Like, for him to lose this fight, the only way for him would be to get knocked out, or for him to be robbed. Those are the only two ways that Floyd loses this fight against Canelo. You look at the stuff going on in the ring, you look at the stats, and you know, Floyd has the best defense in boxing right now. People say, well, look at the Cotto fight, look at the Cotto fight. Well, you know, the Cotto fight doesn't really matter now that you look at things. When you look at things now, you know, people were saying, oh, well, you know, Floyd's legs are gone, you know, he can't move anymore. If he fights anybody like Pacquiao or Canelo, he's done, his speed will be too much, and all this. You know, I'm like, are you serious? Because, you know, the Mosey fight, Freddie Roach said Floyd's legs were gone. And I was like, are you serious? Freddie, are you serious? You know, Floyd said he was going to stand in front of Mosley and fight with him. He said he wasn't going to box or stuff because people complained that he runs. And there were times, if you pay attention, Mosley would come after him and Floyd would be gone. Like, just out of there. Gone. You know, he wasn't standing there to be hit all the time. Now, against Ortiz, and you saw that. You saw that there were times when the physical force would attack and Floyd just quit on his feet and would skip away from it. Okay? And if you look at the Cotto fight, there's no reason Floyd had to stand there right in front of Cotto. One thing that caught my eye is, you see him part early in the fight, Floyd's on the ropes, Cotto's right there, Floyd gets away from him, and you know, a few rounds later, in the middle round, this is the exact same scenario that I saw earlier. If I was watching the fight right now, I'd tell you, you know, what rounds to go and look at. But Floyd was on the ropes, he skipped away from Cotto, got away from him, went back to the center of the ring, and then he was in the exact same scenario, like exact same spot on the ropes, you know. I don't know if it was the same side of the ring they were on before, but it was the exact same spot on the ropes. Instead of circling around back to the middle of the ring like he did before, he moved along the ropes back to the corner. He had no reason to. And the amount of space between him and Kodo, it was more space than he had the first time he did that. Floyd didn't have to stay right in front of Kodo at all in that fight. He didn't have to get hit all those extra times. He could have boxed Kodo and made it a boring fight. Now, he was boxing Kodo from the outside in rounds 1 through 4. Had no problem with, you know, Kodo's jab that they were saying was landing so much, and, you know, was such a big factor since all the sort of people got it in the hands of Oscar De La Hoya, got the blueprint. Oscar De La Hoya don't got no blueprint. He got an idea that he wants to be a blueprint, and that's a different thing. So, we're looking at that Floyd's Kodo fight. And they're saying that Kodo's jab, or like I said, not a little bit though, they said that his jab was effective. Kodo landed 30 jabs the whole fight. Okay? 30. Now, if your jab is really effective, if your jab is really doing something, that's a punch you're gonna land more than just 30 times. You know, you're gonna be landing it a lot. You know, Floyd's jab is more effective than Kodo's. If you look at the fights, Floyd landed 51 jabs in that fight. No, 17%. Now this is Floyd's lowest connect percentage, 26%. It's not because Kodo has good defense, it's because Floyd was sloppy in that fight. Now, everybody knows that in boxing, when you're sloppy, when you're the aggressor, when you go on the offensive, and you throw a lot of punches, that you are going to miss a lot of punches, and you're going to be open more to being hit. Floyd chose to fight Kodo's type of fight, a toe-to-toe fight instead of boxing. So, when you look at that, it's no surprise that Floyd got caught with some punches he wouldn't have been caught with if he boxed instead of, you know, wanting a fight. You know, Kodo's type of fight. When he had no reason to. I mean, you look at these punch stats. You look at these punch stats, and I gotta ask y'all, when is the last time y'all have seen Mayweather throw 700 punches in a fight? He threw 687. That's almost 700. When is the last time, or any time, when have we ever seen Floyd throw up to 500 punches in one fight? Like, ever. When have we seen him be that sloppy? We already know he's not. We've seen that in the Guerrero fight just this last May. I mean, that stuff you have to take into consideration. You know, Floyd was being sloppy in that fight. He didn't have to. He could have boxed Kodo like he did Ortiz and Mosley, you know, from close range without having to stay on the ropes and take extra punishment. When have we ever seen Floyd, you know, sit on the ropes and take punishment like that for no reason? Never. Only other time was with Oscar De La Hoya and Castillo, because they liked to hold and hit the same way Guerrero did against Berto, which is why it didn't work. You know, Floyd knows how to protect his body. That's what he did against Oscar. That's what he did against Castillo. They both tried that same thing. Drag him to the ropes, and hold and hit. Floyd has developed defense for that. I already know Canelo don't fight like that. Also, Canelo ain't used to having somebody wrap him up in the clinch. You know? So, look at all these technical things Mayweather does. Canelo isn't ready for that. He hasn't faced anybody who does any of that. He hasn't faced anybody with the type of accuracy Mayweather has. He hasn't fought anybody who keeps eye contact with their opponent, who's always thinking, who has such a good defense. Like I said, we know what to expect from Mayweather, but you know, the thing is, a lot of people are like, yeah, well, Canelo's a bigger, stronger version of Cotto, so he's gonna, well, no, you can't think like that. Every fight is different. Every fighter is different. So you can't expect what one fighter did to, you know, what another fighter is gonna be able to do it. The way I see this fight going, honestly, I mean, it doesn't even matter. You know what I said Canelo needs to do to win. It doesn't matter what anyone says Canelo needs to do to win. Fact of the matter is, if he doesn't knock Mayweather out, he is not going to win unless they rob Mayweather of the fight. Plain and simple. Unless they rob Mayweather, or Canelo gets a knockout, it's not gonna happen. And even, you know, I've heard some people saying, good friend of mine, I know y'all follow her channel, Boxing Bell, you know, Stephanie Bell. I heard she put out a video like earlier today, or was it yesterday, saying that Mayweather can get robbed, you know, for a trilogy because, you know, they're all businessmen. And then, you know, I have to kindly disagree simply because, yeah, Floyd's a businessman and he likes money, but he likes his perfect record more than money. And I think, I think I might have said this in one of my earlier videos, if y'all didn't catch the interview, because it was an interview on, I forgot what the radio show is that they do on BoxingSocialist.com. I forgot what the name of it is, but they had Nate Jones on there. And if y'all don't know who Nate Jones is, he's the guy who gets on there with the body pad with Mayweather, you know, while he's doing the midwest with Rodgers to do the body pad, the big old black guy. He was on there to interview with him. And this was around the time of the Ortiz fight, like between the Moser and Ortiz fight, somewhere around there. And he was telling the story about how he was spending a night up at Floyd's mansion. He was spending a few days up there, and like he woke up in the middle of the night. You know, Floyd is, you know, a person who stay up late, but for some reason he ain't seen Floyd. He didn't know where he was until like later in the morning. You know, he's seen him, and you know, asked him where he was, and he's like, well, you know, I had a dream about losing the fight, and you know, so I wanted to go run 10 miles. I'm like, okay, so, you know, based on that, if a guy is going to get up and run 10 miles because he had a dream about losing the fight, really think he's going to give it up for some money? And you're like, you know, it's like Stephanie was saying, you know, Oscar De La Hoya, Schaefer, Al Haymon, Mayweather, Ellerby, you know, they're all businessmen. And from a business perspective, to me, it doesn't make sense for Floyd to, you know, give up his zero for more money and potential bouts when he got how many fights left? He got 4 fights left after this. You know, the best way for him, like, you know, it's not a get rich quick thing. You know, do a trilogy, you know, get rich quick and have a lot of money right there. No, it's better for him to stay undefeated. And if they were going to rob him, it would be best to do it for his last fight, because that way he makes more money in the long run. Because, you know, they rob him in the first fight against Canelo. He comes back, like, whoops Canelo, you know, again, you know, the next 2 fights. Yeah, he avenged his loss. And yeah, he gets, you know, that money. But then he'll still retire after the last fight after that. You know, so he'll have that one loss on his record. He'll avenge it, and then, you know, retire after those fights. Like, if they were going to rob him, it'd be better to do it on his last fight, because then he would have made that money with Showtime, you know. And even if he beats Canelo, even if they're going to have a trilogy with Canelo, and he wins all three fights, they rob him on his last one, then, you know, I highly doubt that, you know, considering how much he values his perfect record, that if they rob him on his last fight, I have no reason to think that, you know, he would, I have no reason to think that he would not come back and do something about that after losing that last fight. I mean, that means he could do the rest of his fights with Showtime, and then, you know, if he gets robbed in the last one, come back for a few more fights. That would make more sense than him being robbed against Canelo right now. That's if, you know, they want to make more money. But at the same time, Floyd Mayweather probably knows all this, and he's not gonna put himself in position to lose when he already knows that he can walk out of there with another victory. He's not gonna put himself in position to lose. He's not the type of person. So, with that being said, and knowing that the only way they could rob him is if it's a close fight, you have to look for Floyd to not make it a close fight. You know he won't make it a close fight. You know that he's gonna go out there and do what it takes to win. He's not gonna leave anytime. He knows what's at stake in this fight. He knows that Oscar De La Hoya, you know, is riding on Canelo to be the next big star in boxing. He knows Oscar De La Hoya still holds that grudge against him. He's gonna do everything he can to make Oscar even more miserable. And for him to do that means he has to beat Canelo so bad that there won't even be talk of a rematch. He's gonna have to completely outclass him and embarrass him the way he did Robert Guerrero, the way he did Mosley, the way he did, you know, Ricky Hatton and Juan Manuel Marquez. You know, the way he did Gotti, he's gonna have to put on a performance that just completely leaves his opponent in the dust. And you're gonna have to look for him to do that. You know he's gonna be in better shape, he's gonna be sharper since it's only been 4 months since his last fight. And you know that's the shortest distance between any two fights of his since after he fought Diego Corrales, then fought Carlos Hernandez. Was it Diego before Hernandez? Whatever fight was before Floyd fought Carlos Hernandez. That time period, you know, was the only other time where he fought within 4 months. That's the shortest time between, you know, any two fights for him. So, he's going to be on point. He's going to be on point. He's going to go out there. He's going to embarrass Canelo. I mean, I'm not, like I said, I'm not worried about, you know, any knockout. I don't see a knockout happening. The reason is, like I said before, Canelo didn't wobble Shane Mosley, didn't wobble Jose Cito Lopez. He did beat up Lopez. You know, Lopez was bleeding and he went back with a body shot. But there wasn't a time where I seen Lopez get hit and, you know, he was standing, you know, stanky leg like Austin Trout. Same with Mosley. I didn't see that happen to Mosley neither. So, with that being said, Canelo's gonna have a hard time, very hard time, trying to figure out Mayweather. They say that Canelo is smart. I think he is smarter than, you know, a lot of other fighters out there. I think he does have good technical ability, but I don't think it's enough to where he can make the adjustments that he needs to make, or adjustments he might know he needs to make that can't do it. And with that being said, I can tell y'all, you know, expect.
You ain't doing jack shit here. King, why
don't you just expect something to happen that
ain't nothing gonna change.
Y'all didn't think would happen.
I mean, I'm still gonna be.
I'm willing to say that if there was a knockout, I put money on Mayweather for the knockout to happen.
Cause it's true.
Just based on what I've seen from both of them. Floyd's first fight at 150, not 154, but 147. His first fight at 147, the guy walked into the ring at 165. I think it was Charmaine Mitchell. Charmaine Mitchell, I think, was ranked somewhere in the top. It was either top 10 or top 5 in that weight class at that time. I'm pretty sure he was like number 2 in that weight class at that time. And he walked into the ring at 165, 66. He was above 160. Floyd walked in at 147. And Floyd ended up finishing him with a body shot. You know, Floyd's body shots are underrated. He throws a jab to the body constantly, you know, in all his fights. And he also throws a straight to the body. In close, he likes to throw uppercuts to the body. Canelo has issues with stamina. And he's going to have issues with stamina. The reason is fighting below a weight that he doesn't want, that he walks around at. Mayweather doesn't fight below his walk around weight. Roger Mayweather, a few weeks ago, came out and, you know, told us that Floyd actually walks around now at 145. Before he was walking around 147 to 152. That was around the time of the Ortiz fight. Around last year, sometime last year, Floyd mentioned that he had actually dropped a little weight and he was walking around 147 to 150 versus, you know, 147 to 152. But now, they had an interview with Roger Mayweather. Floyd walks around at 145. So even then, you know, he's a small guy. And he has, and you've seen All Access episode 3. He had to eat, you know, certain foods to be able to put on weight. Even with that, you know, he's still training with ankle weights, so he's used to even more weight than what he has to put on. Canelo doesn't do that. And what's bad for Canelo is, since he walks around above 170, because remember, 4 weeks ago, 4 or 5 weeks ago, he was weighing 166, okay, 166, and he's lost 10 pounds in 4 weeks. If he's lost 10 pounds in 4 weeks, he's at 157 right now. That means that he was walking around above 170 before he started training camp. So, with that being said, what you have to watch out for is trying to maintain that weight. And that's why Mayweather has an advantage, because he doesn't have to worry about losing weight or putting anything extra on when he steps into the ring. Canelo, he's gonna weigh in at whatever on Friday night, and he better hope that he come in at 152. But I think they said that he can probably just go ahead and pay the penalty. I'm not sure. I don't remember. But if he doesn't have to pay a penalty, if that's not there and he has to make the weight, then he's done. If he has to make the weight, he's done. If he has to drain himself to make that weight, he's finished. Like, from the start, there won't even be any more speculation. But even without that, if he comes in at the correct weight, what's going to happen is, yeah, he'll be feeling light and he'll be, you know, feeling fast. But like I said, you all of a sudden wake up the next day and put on your boxing gear and got 20 extra pounds on you, you're going to feel it. It doesn't matter who you are. You'll feel the 20 extra pounds. You're going to feel that. you will feel it. It's going to affect his stamina because, you know, his legs, he's going to be heavier than what his legs have been used to and working out for during the training camp. And he's going to have to work harder to move all that weight around. So he's going to be slower. He is going to be slower. And he's going to get tired easier. I mean, yeah, you've seen him doing like all those sprints on, you know, the all access, but he's not doing those sprints with that extra weight. All that work he's doing in all access is to lose that weight. It's to lose it. So, with that being said, you know, you can't expect Canelo to be as fast or looking as good as he does in his training camp. Not only because of that, but, you know, because he hasn't really been fighting top-notch people in his training camp. I mean, in his training camp, they're doing all the stuff to make him feel good. You know, they're not doing the stuff that's going to, you know, they're doing stuff to make him feel good and look good. They're not doing the type of stuff that's going to, you know, make him to be prepared. That's why Floyd has another advantage, because he keeps his body in shape. You have to have hard work and dedication. You have to be disciplined. And Roger Mayweather was saying, to be successful in boxing or anything, you have to have discipline, and you have to be willing to do work without other people telling you to do work. You know, he said he doesn't even have to tell Floyd that he needs to work hard because he already knows it. You know, I'm not sure how many other boxers will, you know, just wake up in the middle of the night, feel like they need to do some more work, and then go, you know, go work out in the gym and go do some training. Like you've seen for the Ortiz and Cotto fights, Mayweather was in the gym 3 times a day training. There's times you go up in there like 2 or 3 in the morning. But now, you know, he works hard, but, you know, during the nighttime, he takes care of his body, he ices down his hands, takes care of him, he gets massages and stuff. You see that in the 24-7, or not 24-7, but all access. So, you look at all this stuff Mayweather does versus things Canelo does, and it's not easy to say that Canelo, you know, actually stands a chance. And you know, even when you ask other people, you know, who do you think will win between Canelo and Mayweather, like, the reasons they get for Canelo winning is because he's bigger and stronger. They don't say that he does anything good in the ring. They say because he's bigger and stronger. But, I mean, you can't say that he does anything good in the ring that Floyd hasn't seen before, better than anyone that he's already fought. You can't say that. And if you can, I'd like to see who. Motherfucker, have a seat and loosen up. Get a glass of some gin. That's all I've got. Y'all stay tuned for the fight. You know that I'm going to do a video after that fight. We understand each other. You know that fight won't be interesting. Like I said, like me personally, I could be wrong, because you never know. One punch changes everything. And if Canelo's going in hoping for that one punch, then, you know, just waiting on it is going to be too late before he decides to, before he gets the chance to do anything, or before he realizes it. But that being said, like I said, you know, if there's a knockout coming, I expect it to be from Floyd by a TKO stoppage. Not knocked out cold, but like some TKO or something. I don't see anybody getting knocked out cold or 10 count, none of that. For real. But a TKO, I could see Mayweather having it based on the fact that, you know, Canelo doesn't pay attention when his opponents move, but while he's throwing the punch at close range, he takes his eyes off his opponent. And the fact that he tends to retreat and go extremely defensive whenever an opponent, you know, throws a flurry at him and is landing. So they throw a combo at him and they're landing. Canelo tends to go on the defensive and turtle up, shell up, freeze kind of. So based on that, that's why I see a TKO coming from Floyd. I don't see one coming from Canelo simply because he's not gonna be able to touch Floyd cleanly enough for that to happen unless, you know, Floyd completely abandons his defense. So, like I said, you know, it's gonna be a good fight. I'm already excited for this weekend. I want the week to be over. But, you know, unfortunately, we still got a couple more days, still got 5 more days, so, until then, y'all take it easy.